Hey guys, so the video you're about to see is me and Gabe from Rational Typology, or maybe you know him from Warmest Robot. It's me and Gabe having a conversation. It's basically, in my mind, a TEFI conversation that is the Warmest Robot an ethical thing to do? Is it the most productive thing to do? And we take kind of two different stances on the topic, and we just kind of like debate each other as we go. And it's kind of an interesting video because you can see our arguments get a little bit better as time goes on. It's not the most concise video, it's like an hour and a half long, but if you're interested in that sort of thing, this is basically two INTJs just debating each other back and forth. One thing that Gabe and I wanted to mention about this though, like as soon as Gabe and I got done, we got off the Zoom call, my husband was like, "Are you okay? Are things okay?" And from an outside perspective, from some different personality types, apparently it looked pretty tense, but when Gabe and I got off the call, we were like, I don't know, I guess on his end, but on my end, I was pretty just like jazzed up. Like I was feeling like pretty good about how the whole thing went. And we've had several calls since then, and we're gonna have more calls. So like we're friends. So it's not like a, I always wanted to make it clear that it was just like a friendly debate, and this is just how INTJs communicate with each other, and we enjoy doing it. So yeah, this is a video kind of debating this. I hope you like it. Hey everybody, welcome back to my channel. I have Gabriel here with me from Rational Typology.
Hey, what's up?
Yeah, you want to say anything about yourself or what other channels you have?
Hey, I'm from Rational Typology. I also have the Warmest Robot, if you're interested. But that's quite edgy, though. So if you're not into that, then I guess don't go there.
Nice. Yeah, you want to tell them a little bit about your like philosophy, I guess, behind the Warmest Robot?
Yeah, sure.
Or maybe tell them what it is also, if they don't know what it is.
Oh, it's like a channel where we tease people for, because we think they're wrong, right? So it's a pretty odd concept. yeah, so the reason that it's that it was made is because I think it's easier to mess up systems than fix systems or make them better or even to maintain systems. So if you give somebody advice and it's wrong and then they take it, then it's going to make their life worse. So you should criticize advice as good as you can without resorting to fallacies or personal attacks.
Yeah. So yeah, so in your opinion, you're doing it in order to basically correct the fallacies.
Yeah, and kind of get like an overarching idea of how that thinking happens.
Illogical thinking.
Yeah, because it's like every fallacy has been repeated endlessly by the human species.
Yeah,
because it's something you have to actually learn to avoid. It's not an innate thing.
So when you started this channel and you're kind of like teasing people for their logical fallacies, did you ever struggle with like, is this an ethical thing to do?
No, not really.
Really? No.
Because I don't know why it would be unethical, right?
Oh, okay. I guess it would depend on like how much of the content is making fun of logic and making fun of a person, maybe.
Well, a person is composed of their systems, and if their systems are wrong, then the person's wrong, and they should be caught out for it. That's why you should let go of bad beliefs.
Right. But then I suppose...
I guess
it depends on how they're being called out, maybe, if it would be unethical.
Like, what would be an unethical example?
I would say resulting to other logical fallacies. So if you end up resulting... to ad hominem attacks or in making fun of their hyperbole, you become so hyperbolic, then it's just creating another logical fallacy.
Okay, so if you're resorting to ad hominems, then you're attacking the person for being the person, and that's why they're wrong, which that in itself is wrong. But that's just why it's an ad hominem. Yeah, so that would be inappropriate.
So, inappropriate?
Like that would be a logical fallacy itself. So therefore, then I should be the subject of my own teasing.
So you think you should not do ad hominem attacks? Is that what you're saying?
I think that defeats the purpose.
Right, right. Yeah, so how do you know if... Yeah, there's a I feel like there's a fine line between teasing and then ad hominem. How do you differentiate? Like, where's the line?
Oh, okay. So the line isn't too hard. It's if they're wrong because they're them, right? So that is an ad hominem. So for example, and I don't believe this. This is just an example of something that is wrong. But if I were to say you're wrong because of your hair color, that would be wrong because it's not responding to the argument. Right. Or it's like, I was like, you've got no idea what you're talking about because no one with that hair color could possibly think appropriately. It's responding to the person, not the argument.
Right, right.
But it isn't an homonym to say you are wrong and you've also got that hair color.
What do you feel about like name calling? Like if you just say you're stupid.
I think I'm okay with that based on my actions. Yeah.
How do you justify standing up for the name of logic and then name calling?
Well, they're not separate things.
Name calling. See, to me, that's a similar. It's just like where logic falls short, muscle prevails. It's one of those things. It's like when your logic has fallen short, you result to name calling.
That is a trend. Doesn't make it. It's not an argument. There we go.
Yeah, right. Calling someone stupid. Yeah, it's definitely.
Yeah, it just isn't an argument. That doesn't make the argument wrong either.
Yeah. Well, sure. It wouldn't make your argument wrong, but don't you think it would detract from the argument?
No, it doesn't affect it. It's a separate point.
Well, no. I mean, like from the viewer's perspective. So calling someone stupid in no way, like, falls in line with any deductive reasoning or, you know, has to do with any argument. But from a viewer's perspective, if they see, okay, you're making fun of someone for being illogical and then you call them stupid, then they're like, oh, well, this person probably could have articulated that in a better way, but they chose to call them stupid, which makes me feel like maybe they're not intelligent enough to have come up with an argument. They had to name call.
That would ironically be a logical fallacy. So, oh,
which logical fallacy is it?
Okay, so a good way to think about it is if you respond to anything but the argument, mm-hmm. then it's wrong, right? So if someone were to say, if you're being mean, then therefore you're being wrong. It's not responding to the argument itself.
No, not that they would say you were wrong, but that they would find you then, everything in the argument could be fine. You could have like 59 minutes of coherent logical argument, but then you call someone stupid or whatever for 1 minute of it. You call someone stupid or whatever and you name call. It doesn't mean that any part of the other 59 minutes is wrong, but it means like when I take you as a person, I may be less inclined to see you as someone maybe respectable, whereas if it was someone respectable, then I'd be more inclined to appreciate what they say about someone who is not respectable.
Yeah, I mean, sure, that's fine. like it's just as a preference, right?
Yeah,
it's like in it's like the same way that that somebody might choose to get a like a specific gender of a doctor. It's preference. Doesn't mean it's right. It just means that someone thinks that thing.
You don't see it at all? You don't like?
Well, I just don't think it, like, I probably just filter out insults in such a fundamental way that I don't really see them as valuable or significant. But they're funny, and so that's why I think it's appropriate.
Oh, okay.
But people don't have to say it that way. Like, it's a preference.
Sure, sure. Do you find the Warmest Robot, for example, do you find that to be ethical or neutral?
I think it's chaotically ethical. There we go.
Okay, can you describe that?
Okay, so I think it is in the service of getting people to correct their thinking, but it is at the expense of people. So it's both. Having said that, if not that they will, but if those people chose to be reasonable, then would benefit them if they were to examine the points and try to make addendums to their thinking to make themselves more correct in a systemic way. But they weren't, and that's kind of why it's funny.
So is the point mostly so that viewers will change their opinion?
So I think that it's to point out why they're wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's not necessarily to get them to change action. There's no outcome attached to it.
Like maybe viewers might change their mind about how they think about things. I have heard people say that has been useful from a looking at how things are wrong perspective. So
yeah.
that's probably valuable for them. Like maybe. I think it is also just funny, like purely from a comedic perspective.
Sure, sure. Yeah, I think like when I toss it around in my mind, because we've talked about this a little bit before, and I talked to my husband about it, and he completely finds it ethical. And with him being an IFP, I trust his opinion more so than my own, but there's still something in my mind. There's some dissonance that I'm not like, I don't know. On the one hand, I could see it as ethical if it was kind of like, depending on the person, if it's kind of like standing up to a bully, sort of. Like if there are these creators who say really illogical things and they specifically do it in a, not only are they illogical, but they're also mean in the way that they do things. Then if you had another person who kind of came along and like, I don't know, I hate calling it a bully, but like stood up to a bully or something. Then I find that to be pretty much ethical, especially if you use equal or less force than what the bully did, or at least not extremely more force than whatever they did. But then if some person resulted to some bullying techniques themselves, then I just see them as kind of like another one of those bullies. I just kind of lump them in that same category.
I'm not sure what a bully means or what force means.
Yeah, so by bullying, I don't know. It's kind of a bad word for this scenario, but the way I'm thinking of it is just someone who is seen potentially as like a leader and is potentially leading others astray, and especially in a harmful way. And then other people are at the expense of their success.
Okay, that seems like two separate claims. Because if you're successful enough or good enough building rapport to get people to adhere to your philosophy, then it's on the individual people to do that. That's not that person's fault because they didn't make that decision. So I'd say it's up to each individual to decide what is appropriate for them to adhere to. And like that includes like fans of C.S. Joseph, right? It's all on them to adhere to ideas that don't make a lot of sense. And yeah, so that's all their responsibility. That's all their individual responsibility. And then when it comes to having some benefit off them, then, because I couldn't really say that he's the like I'd want an example of that to know if it was okay or not.
of an example of
like an example of where someone would benefit of somebody somebody that lost something and then the person gained something. Like I want to know what that would be so I could understand it properly.
Where someone lost something?
Yeah.
I'm not sure what you're referencing actually.
Like if they gain something at someone's expense, what would that be?
Oh, so like potentially in the example of like in C.S. Joseph, if he says sexist things at the expense of women, he's getting followers.
Oh, okay. Well, I think that would link back to the initial assertion, where if he's popular, and I don't know if he's sexist properly, I suspect that he's generalized his issues when it comes to women to all women, and that does seem unhealthy. So that definitely could be sexist. I don't know enough to properly be able to say in a definitive way though. But if he is getting followers because he's specifically being mean to women, then that's on them. Like that's because they're susceptible to those beliefs. Like that's their individual responsibility to not be susceptible or to be receptible, depending on what the beliefs are.
So I'm kind of not sure what the, like TE wise, what the purpose of the videos are besides entertainment, because if it's up to like individual consumers to make their decisions, you know, it's up to them if they want to, you know, listen to C.S. Joseph, it's up to them if they want to believe your argument, you know, but it's not really the point, you know, like if it's up to individual choice. So it's not really about swaying the viewer's opinion. And if you believe that the creators themselves, like C.S. Joseph, for example, are not going to change their ways, then I'm not sure, like I'm looking for an outcome. Like what's the point besides entertainment?
Well, the point would be to change minds. Those statements aren't disconnected. It is your individual responsibility to be responsible for what you believe. And it's also true that people change their minds when exposed to different kinds of argument. And especially if people don't, like, especially if you haven't been exposed to what a critical analysis is, and it's like, it's not taught in schools, for example, and it's not common knowledge, like how to break down arguments. And so I think if some people want to focus on that and then make it more widespread, then I think that would be a net positive.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I see. Well, okay. So I'm all fine with the breaking down arguments, especially if it was done in a unemotional way. I think it's the entertainment value that I find to be unethical or at least questionable.
Because it's mean. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like I'm fine with people breaking down people's arguments. Like if someone, I don't know, if someone came on and was like, you know, responding to a C.S. Joseph video and they were pretty much flat about it, flat in tone and somewhat objective, then I'd be more fine with it. But I don't know. I don't know. It's where it's if it steps into being mean, then all of a sudden I'm like, I don't know.
Why? Because you're not the arbiter of nice. And what's mean to you is going to be different to what's mean to other people.
Yeah, but mean and nice is a spectrum. And I might as well choose to try to be as far on the kind side of things as possible.
Yeah, that's true.
Probably, you know, it's probably impossible. I can't ever just be 100% nice, but I might as well give it a go.
Yeah, I mean, that's true. I mean, it's true that it's a spectrum, but it's not like a solid spectrum, because it's going to be interpreted. It's going to be interpreted in different ways by different people.
So like, well, true. I mean, it's subjective, but there are some things that, you know, if you were going to poll 100 people, hey, do you think this is nice or do you think this is mean? I mean, there are things that the majority of the population is going to find meaner than the majority of the population is going to find other things. It's not going to be an objective measurement, but they're just like, if I say I like your hair, if I say I hate your hair, we can basically agree that one of them's nicer than the other.
Maybe. Probably in the same culture, that's true. But then it gets more complex when it gets cross-culture.
Yeah, I mean, I would find that to be very few instances. Like, I would just imagine that ad hominem attacks are basically going to be considered rude across cultures. Or calling someone stupid is probably going to be considered rude across cultures.
Well, I know a lot of people in Australia that just use offensive language as part of their, like, everyday speech.
Well, I understand, like, teasing. Like, so you have a friend and you're like, oh, you're so stupid or whatever. You say that to a spouse or something. I mean, there, I guess there's supposed to, like, different contexts. But in the context of a video where you're calling someone illogical and you're like, that is so stupid. You are so stupid. It.
Yeah. Well,
I don't know that that's a cultural thing.
Okay, that definitely is more common where I live. But
well, I'd say it's not more common. It probably, I'm sure it is more common.
but as for the point of nice,
account, then, but then you'd have to, if you, you know, if someone was concerned about that, you'd have to take into account, you then have to be like, okay, what percent of my viewers are in the US? Okay, C.S. Joseph lives in the US, and so I don't know if you would take that into account.
I'm going by my ethics, not other people's.
This reasoning is getting circular.
Well, like, as to your point of what is nice, I think it's going to, like, it depends on how you think about it. Because if you get someone, like, I think that if you tease people about what is false, then it allows people to see how thinking like that leads to bad situations. So I'd probably agree that it's not nice, but I'd say it probably would be kind.
Well, but here, the breaking down of someone's argument, I have no problem with. It's the delivery. Like, I don't have a problem with the message as much of the tool that you're using to communicate it through. Like, pointing out the fallacy in someone's logic, and so then other people can see the fallacy in someone's logic. I think that's a good thing to do. I have zero problems with it. It's only the teasing. It's only the calling someone stupid, or to the point where it almost makes a straw man out of their argument.
I'd need an example of that, but I get the impression that it's important to you to keep rapport with people. Or that you think that people should obtain a kind of rapport with each other. Would that be correct?
It's very different. If you were talking to C.S. Joseph directly, like, let's say you're in a room with him, I have less of a problem with it if you call him stupid to his face. I have more of a problem with it if it's on a platform where it's like you're not talking to him, you're talking about him. And it's kind of like, it's almost kind of like gossiping, like making fun of someone behind their back, sort of, publicly to a bunch of people.
But or it's public.
A better example is like, I don't know, I could, like, school examples, like, or if, like, you're in a cafeteria and he's just like say C.S. Joseph was sitting right there and you're just like making fun of him and he's in earshot, I guess. I don't know, but you're not like talking to him.
But it's not, that's not the situation. Because if, like, I would totally talk to him, it would be great.
See, I would like that so much more. Like, if you guys did, like, a live stream or something,
Oh, he's not going to talk to us.
Well, yeah, but you know why he's not going to talk to you is because you've set it up where you're like making fun of him. And so you've shut the door. It's the most productive form of communication.
No, I disagree that that would be productive. that, because them, like, minds are not predicated off sound reasoning. They can be in some people, not in general. And it's definitely not with people like C.S. Joseph. Because it's like, regardless of what I said to him, he would not change his positions.
Right, which is why I come back to the point. Like, I find it kind of pointless because he's not going to change his position.
It's not about
the individuals are going to change their positions.
It's not about the subject. It's about the people that are observing the subject.
So, okay. So if there was a productive video that you had, like a productive outcome would be that some number, like 1,000 of people who initially followed C.S. Joseph no longer follow him. Is that a productive outcome? And they see, okay, there's an error in his logic. I no longer want to follow this person.
I think, I mean, yes, yeah, that would be good. That along with people knowing how to check for that kind of reasoning. Because it's likely that in some point in your life, you're going to meet someone equivalent to C.S. Joseph. And if you're not prepared for the kind of logical loopholes that he's utilizing, then it might make your life way more difficult than it needs to be.
Sure. See, once again, I'm fine with pointing out the holes in people's logic. Like, I am on board with like the equipping of people, and I see that as a valid outcome. Do you think you would have more of that outcome? I think maybe you would, if there was not like calling him stupid in videos.
I think that probably not. No, probably not.
You don't think you'd have a better outcome?
I think we'd have a different outcome. But I think it is a kind of an art form in itself. Like anything is, and that it is offensive is pretty irrelevant to me. Like, I understand that it is offensive and people are entitled to that opinion, and I don't perceive it that way.
It's like I actually, you know, on a personal level, I enjoy kind of, it's not something that I'm necessarily proud of, but I enjoy videos when people make fun of other people. I mean, it's kind of like, it's not a great thing. I've seen, like, as a separate from like this example, I've seen videos where people like have made fun of Donald Trump, and I've seen videos where they did a bunch of like name calling and they made fun of him for being orange and, you know, all the stuff, and it's funny. And then I've seen videos where people are more more level-headed about it, and the ones where they're calling him names and stuff, like you take like a Stephen Colbert or someone, like they're funny. But I have less respect for like a Stephen Colbert than for someone who could attack an argument without resulting to emotional grabs of humor.
Oh, it doesn't need to be separate. I think that might be a division in thinking. Because I do agree with the point, if this is what you're making, that people will resort in emotional attacks if they lack a sound argument. Because I think that does happen. And I think that is a bad argument. And then it's an insult. And the insult can be funny. But it's not funny if it's not predicated on a sound argument.
So do you only... Well... So the only insults you would make are insults directly related to the argument, or no?
The argument, Okay, so I kept on calling C.S. Dreyfus a C.S. Joseph, a prankster,
A prankster.
which
It's kind of a prank.
because he says absurd things, and you can examine it through the context of he's just wrong, but you can also examine it from the context of that he's just trying to deceive people, and that would make him a prankster. And I don't quite know which one he is. I'm more inclined to think that he's just wrong, but I don't know for sure. Therefore, he might be a prankster.
Kind of a random example. See, that sort of thing I don't have a problem with. Prankster. What other names do you call?
Well, it's mostly predicated off what their argument is. So it doesn't make sense out of context.
So if you
It's
call
like
people stupid, because you told me that you call people stupid, it's only because the argument is stupid? Do you say
yeah.
you are, do you say like C.S. Joseph is stupid, or do you say the argument is stupid?
I'll say that. Okay, if you produce the argument, then that makes a person stupid. Yeah. That's how that works. Yeah. I probably wouldn't say it in that way because it wouldn't be funny. I'd probably be something like, you said this and you said this and this doesn't make sense. Do you know that you're stupid?
Sheesh. That's so interesting. What are your values? Like, what are things that you think people should do morally?
Okay, I think people should engineer systems of engagement that are sustainable, along with promoting a enjoyable experience long term. Which is why I'm against things like extreme drug use. Because if you look at the whole experience, it's not good. Like the first bit's all right, and then afterwards it's miserable.
You see that people should take actions that will promote long-term enjoyment. So you said?
Yeah.
Interesting. Enjoyment for the individual, for you. You should do things that you will long-term enjoy.
So for the individual and people that are engaging in the same game. So the behavior that you do, you should expect people to treat you in the same way, or at least be able to tolerate. So if somebody made a video of me calling me a fucking idiot because I like can't talk right, or because I said a bunch of wrong shit, then that would be fine. And if it was like true, then I'd be like, good job, man, you or woman, good job, future person, for pointing out how I was a fucking idiot. Now I can improve.
But do you think you would ever see the logic in their argument?
Yeah, because we have had like comments that were just true, and we were wrong about things, and then we said it in the next video.
Oh, okay. What sorts of things are that? Is that like logical things or like what sorts of things?
No, okay, so it was because he said a term, and I didn't know where it came from, and then I found out later on that it was like a Greek philosophy. And I just didn't know that at the time.
Oh,
Yeah,
okay.
so I was wrong about that.
Oh, okay. Yeah, nice.
Having said that, you have to be able to judge criticism as well, because there's a lot of stupid criticism as well as useful criticism, and you need to have some kind of metric for
Right.
segregating those things.
Yeah, how do you sort that out?
Like if it's logically sound, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah, I think sometimes with criticism, like on YouTube, for example, I'll look at like, is it repetitive? Like if it's a repetitive criticism, that maybe there's something at least in part wrong with what I'm doing.
I mean, I don't know.
It's
It depends where you
specific.
go. Like it
Like
depends where you It depends on where you go.
Like, I repeatedly got the comment that my volume was too low in my videos.
Oh, that's fair. Okay.
So it's like, okay, a bunch of people are saying this. Okay, the volume's too low.
Yeah. Yeah, because it could be repetitive in the way that, like, if you go to, like, a flat earther forum and you tell them that the earth is not flat, that doesn't make any sense, then you get called a globetard for the next, like 20 comments. Like, okay, well, maybe I'm a globetard.
Yeah, or I looked at, like, if criticism is relatively specific, like, I think that's part of it being logical. Like, if it's very clear what they're saying. Like, sometimes you get, like, vague comments. Like, you don't know what you're talking about or something like that. And you're like, I don't know what to do with that. Like, what would you like me to do about that? Which part? Which part was bad?
Like, I can't work with that. It's too big. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Would it be your... So, I asked you before that... if reaching consensus was something that you cared about, and you said that the problem is because it seems like it's gossip, or because it seems like it's not directly talking to them, would that be the point?
Yeah, well, I mean, I've given examples. There are times when it's fine if you're not directly talking to them. But if you're not directly talking to them and it's mean, then there's a problem. It's like when those two things are in conjunction. If it does happen to be mean.
Well, you said earlier that that you found it amusing when people were to tease Donald Trump for...
I'm saying I'm being unethical. Like, I'm just admitting to not necessarily, like, being
I want to know why it's unethical, because that doesn't seem unethical to me, because as a public platform they can respond, that'll be fine.
I'm just saying, like, I don't have any problem with it, like, legally, for example, or from, like, a logical standpoint. I have no problem with it. Like, I could make fun of someone, they could make fun of me. I mean, it's all, you know, I suppose, like, fair play legally, you know, you do it. But there comes a point, like, if you're seeking long-term enjoyment, if I'm like 90 years old and I look back on my life, and this could just be like an individual, like, purpose thing, I wouldn't be proud of the time that I spent making fun of people. I would be more proud of the time spent, like, out of all the options of things I can do to spend my time on. I would be more proud of creating new things. And instead of being a critic and attacking bad ideas, I would prefer to be the vulnerable one in the ring, trying to assert good ideas and making mistakes along the way, but eventually getting better and better ideas.
Why do you think there's a difference in that? Because if
being you're... a critic versus the one in the ring.
Well, if you're criticizing ideas, it means that you think they're wrong. So you are trying to present better ideas as a consequence.
Yeah, I mean, there are just levels. I mean, I could assert bad ideas. I could attack bad ideas. I could create mediocre ideas. I could create good ideas. I mean, this is a spectrum to me, which I think is most impressive. I suppose not morally wrong, but... I don't know, just more impressive.
I think that that most good ideas are a result of people figuring out complex systems and what the best solution to that is. And a part of that is just criticism. That doesn't mean that people do that correctly, but that is a part of it. Because, like, if we look at, like, the best knowledge that humans have developed, it's, like, probably science. And, like, a lot of that is scientists trying to disprove other scientists about how they're wrong.
Well, see, I think that's great. Like, I don't have any problem with the disproving of things, like especially if I try to put out good Myers-Briggs videos, for example, and I get criticism about like definitions or needing to tighten up my definitions, for example, that's good criticism for me to get, because then that will lead me to tighten up my definitions and then create better videos and things like that. But so the criticism is good. I think it's ultimately helpful, but I would just rather be the one fumbling around trying to do it versus the one criticizing. And there's probably roles. I mean, like other people probably just have different life goals than I do. This is just like a personal like life goal of mine. I wouldn't want people to make fun of me, but I would want criticism to get better ideas.
Is there a difference between criticizing and making fun? Would it be like a delivery thing?
It's the tube through which the message is communicated.
Okay.
I mean if someone said I had like a bad definition, then I'm like, oh yeah, that's great. But if someone's like, you have a bad definition, so you're stupid, then I'm like, it means I got one thing wrong. I don't know if that means I'm stupid. You could say the argument is stupid, but I don't know that we're all stupid.
I think everyone's stupid. especially myself.
Make the difference, I suppose.
Well, I think that if you're trying to hang on to like pretty much just arbitrary concepts like smart or stupid or clever, it's like that doesn't mean anything. It's just made up. It's like made up words that reference things so vague that it has no actual meaning.
Why do you say that?
Oh,
it's also stupid if it has no meaning.
It's like an aesthetic thing.
In what way?
I think it's funny. Like it's an aesthetic quality, like more than anything else.
I see the entertainment value.
And
it just kind of reminds me of like drama channels on YouTube. I don't know if you're familiar with drama channels, like the channels that'll just like make videos like making fun of like makeup YouTubers like randomly. I don't know. I
often find them pathetic because they don't examine the arguments right. But if they were to examine the arguments right, I think they were cool. Probably not makeup channels because I don't know anything about that. But if you switch the subject around.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I suppose with makeup channels, it's a little bit different because there's almost always like not really going to be an argument here.
But making someone laugh is a good thing to do.
Yeah, but is making someone laugh at the expense of someone else a good thing to do?
Can be.
Why?
Because that person has a philosophy that is harmful to people.
But is, okay, so let's say you and I get off this call, I go to my husband and we make fun of you. How does that benefit anyone?
Well, you might think it's funny. And I wouldn't care.
But ultimately, I just feel like whatever you're putting out into the world, you're going to attract more of it. And so if I just go around making fun of people, I'm going to attract other people that enjoy just making fun of people. And ultimately, that's going to lead to less enjoyment in my life. Because if it's in a rude way, not teasing, I like teasing and like that sort of thing. But like if it's literally rude, like me and Garrett are seriously like being rude about you.
So I'm not sure what that would. So I'd predicate it off the argument itself.
I don't know.
Like I think if you and Garrett were to say something, like I'd probably want to know what it is, and then I'll judge it based on how valid the arguments are.
Yeah. I see. I mean, I can see from a perspective of like just an entertainment value. Like the humor is going to make viewers stay longer. When you talk about someone else, that's just going to up your viewership if that person has a higher viewership than you do. So I can see from a like a channel growth perspective why it would be good. For long-term growth, I'm not quite sure what the move would be. Like, do you see yourself doing this for 40 years?
I think the MBTI thing will get kind of old after a bit. With the when they kind of like figured out how people are wrong in the same kind of way, then I think it would get boring.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think it's like a, like it depends on what the argument is, and then that's the only thing that actually matters to me. And then if the insult is funny, then that's a plus. But it's not an argument, so it doesn't matter. Having said that, it can be funny, and then that's like an aesthetic quality.
Okay, what if we just hopped off the call and it was not about an argument? What if we just hopped off the call and we're like, wow, this guy is ugly and stupid?
Well, that's not, like, that isn't an argument.
Right, that's what I said. It's not an argument.
Yeah.
But I'm wondering, do you find that ethical, unethical, neutral?
I'd say by itself is neutral.
Why is that neutral?
Oh, it doesn't matter. It's just like random claim. Like, okay.
But don't you think it will harm me in the long run? You will not find out. You wouldn't find out about it, likely. But you don't think it would harm me in the long run?
Jerk. It definitely could be emblematic of a deeper behavior that might be bad for the person. Yeah, that's true.
Okay, so that would make it unethical.
Well,
it would probably lead to less enjoyment for me in the future, probably.
Yeah, but it would be emblematic of you doing something that might be harmful to yourself.
Right.
Yeah.
So is it unethical?
Well, in the same way that like not eating enough is unethical. Like, that's not very good for you. You probably should probably not do that.
But you think not eating enough is unhealthy but not unethical?
Well, I think that's about the equivalent. Yeah. It's like, it's not very good for you. It causes unnecessary problems, and that's going to cause you pain. So you probably shouldn't do that.
So do you think calling people stupid could cause you unnecessary pain?
It depends on what the motivations were.
Or your personal motivations?
Or just a person in question, yeah. Like maybe if they were doing it because of let's assume for argument's sake that a person has deep-seated issues about being abandoned, and therefore they lash out at people to try to make themselves feel powerful, and therefore they think people won't abandon them. That'll be unhealthy because of the underlying emotional structures.
Do you have a big goal that you want to achieve in life, or a certain career or anything? I don't know.
I'm not sure. I think I like figuring out how people work, and I like making systems around how to work better. So if I can find a way to monetize that, I will.
Yeah, no, that's interesting. Yeah, would you want to, do you have an idea of how you could monetize that, or you don't know?
I've got some ideas, but they're not specific enough to talk about.
Yeah. And do you feel like, I mean, kind of the way I operate is I'll have like a life goal, and then I try to make sure that whatever I'm doing today is congruent with that, or is moving me in that direction. Do you do that?
I've never really had a life goal in particular, because I can't think of anything of sufficient value to spend that much time on. Because I'm not that kind of Like, I could think of how to do things well in the future, or just how to do things, but I never really set on a specific thing. But it's I spent probably most of my life figuring out how like how to resolve philosophical questions, but that's really pointless from like a monetary perspective.
Yeah, resolving philosophical questions, that's kind of a fun thing. But at some point with a lot of philosophical questions, you eventually get down to people's fundamental like beliefs. It's like eventually you hit like a rock bottom that you just cannot.
Yeah, I mean, that's true. I mean, I wasn't doing it to actually help people. It was more to resolve internal problems that I had.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, I think in some of the conversation that we're having, like, about, like, the warmest robot, for example, eventually you get to a bottom that you can't, like, it's just, you've, like, dug and dug and dug, and you, it's like you hit rock, and it's like we just, you have foundational different beliefs. And I think potentially for you and I, that could be that I'm a Christian. And so, and I think that would, that could make us differ in what we feel like is kind.
That might be true. Yeah. Cause I'm not a Christian. I've got nothing against Christians either. Like I'm not that kind of not that kind of person. Cause like I've met a lot of really nice Christians. But I'm not a Christian, cause unfalsifiable beliefs is something I won't have.
Yeah. And I can put myself in the perspective of like having a philosophy that you should do things that will yield long-term enjoyment. I think most of the time that would probably line up with Christian beliefs.
That's true.
Or at least good Christian beliefs. I'm trying to think if there's an example where those two wouldn't line up. That's why I've been trying to think about that for a while, and I haven't thought of one so far. Well, maybe dying. I don't know what you think about this. Like, if someone came to my house, I would not feel good about shooting them. Oh, this is actually probably different because you're in Australia and I'm in America. And guns are
everything. Feel good about shooting them. What, like, is it a postman? I wouldn't murder a postman.
No, I'm sorry. This is a very cultural example. If someone broke into my house, I hear about this in America all the time. This probably is not a normal topic of conversation. This is the topic of conversation. Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Okay. You're like kind of frozen.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Nice. Yeah. So like a common scenario that I end up discussing with people in America is if someone broke into your house in the middle of the night and they wanted to like murder your kids, let's say, yeah. I would not shoot them. Lots of people in America have guns. Lots of people in America would shoot them. Almost everyone I come into contact with would shoot them. Yeah. Even like Christians that I talk to, which I feel like that goes against Christian values, but I wouldn't shoot them. I would be fine using non-lethal defense, but I wouldn't shoot them.
Okay. I think it would be justified to shoot them.
Yeah, see, maybe that's an example where it would be different. I could see this be justified, but I don't know.
Because I
wouldn't do it. I can see why someone would, but I wouldn't.
I think there is a moral cost to inaction as well as action. So if you decide not to do a thing, especially if they're likely to repeat bad behavior, then I wouldn't feel bad about that.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't do nothing. I would, I don't know what I do. You know what I wish that was more common? If you had like, what are they called? And it's like a blunt force. It comes out of a gun, but it doesn't kill people. And it's like a blunt force. I'd be fine with that. Or like tasing someone or macing someone. Like, I'm fine with that. Like, I wouldn't do nothing.
I think that the prison system isn't really set up to stop people from behaving badly, at least in Australia and also America. And so I don't think there would be I don't think it would be morally bad to kill somebody that was trying to kill you, because they're likely to cause perpetual misery until they stop functioning.
See, this issue actually probably parallels the warmest robot like that, because it's a similar idea to me in my head. A much less severe example, but where it's like C.S. Joseph is like, in this analogy, it's like C.S. Joseph is gunning people down and you find it permissible to gun him down.
I mean, maybe with ideas, but
I mean, it's not literal.
Like it's way more silly.
Right. It's much lower level, much lower level. Yeah, that's the thing. It's just like you just fundamentally come down to different, and I just like don't know. So once you get to that place, I'm just like, I don't know where you go from there, because you've just hit a bottom where I don't know, you just don't.
Well, I think that you should treat people either on your principles or their principles. If their principles are less sustainable than yours, then you have to.
Okay, well, in that case, there is a sense of have to. Like, if someone breaks it, like, it's going to shoot you or whatever, there is a sense of have to. With, like, C.S. Joseph, there's not a sense of have to. Like, there's no one, like, you don't have to.
Yeah, that's true. And I don't. Like, I don't straw man him or make up things about what he's done that I don't know about.
Yeah. Well, so, like, what you've talked about is that you like to treat people logically. And then if they're, like, not getting it, and if they're not going to come around to logic, then you have to use other tactics, like teasing them, for example.
Well, I would probably tease my friends as well, and they would tease me, and that is sustainable for us. But I wouldn't treat all friends like that, because I know that people don't like it, and I wouldn't cause unnecessary conflict in that situation.
Well, but see, with a friend, like, I like teasing and, like, making fun of friends, but the difference is that, like, C.S. Joseph is not your friend, presumably.
I mean, I don't know how he feels about me. Maybe he's a fan.
We've never spoken, right?
Yeah, but like maybe he is like a secret fan.
Well, he could be a fan. He's not a friend.
Like maybe the thing about being a prankster is true, and then therefore he secretly likes what we're doing. but you seem to think it's okay to tease people in some situations.
Yeah, no, teasing's fine.
Yeah,
sorry. It's never seen like it's the intent. If you tease a friend, like ultimately, like you have enough like history and relationship built there that's like fine. And if you tease them, like even if you're serious, like about something that they did, and you're like teasing them like seriously because they did something dumb. Like, I mean, you have the relationship and the rapport built to do it, and they probably would listen to it because there's history there. And to me, that seems like a productive action. But with someone you don't have history with, I'm just unproductive. Like, I would love it if someone could make a video and people would change their logic, but I don't think that they will.
But people will. Not the person you're responding to, but people will.
Yeah. I don't know. What if you would not be open to, well, I suppose just like not really your style or whatever, but you wouldn't be open to making a video that critiques someone's logic but does not make fun of them.
Yeah, no, yeah, That's fine. It would depend on some factors though. So, I'll tease people if they have a cluster of mentalities, such as if I perceive them to be like arrogant or smug, I think, or unnecessarily angry or hostile. Or alternatively, giving actually harmful advice, then that justifies that response. If someone is just like they just don't actually know, but their intentions are just to understand things, and I wouldn't justify a response like that.
Yeah, so it seems like you really have a belief that it depends on whatever that person's behavior is, and if they have a certain behavior, it will justify your behavior.
I think it just isn't funny if that isn't happened.
Well, I mean, that's true. I mean,
So like for example, I found a person that they were calling themselves an INTP, and they weren't, and probably like an ESFJ, and they were really good at like explaining how they were doing things, and they were describing their functions in a very accurate way, but being the wrong type. And they seemed to have good intentions, and they were giving genuinely good advice for their own type, but they were wrong about what type they were. And I think in that situation, it would be more appropriate to be like, okay, this is why you're not that type, and then explain why that is the case. And it wouldn't actually be funny to tease them about it.
Okay. That is just such, I cannot imagine changing my course of action based on someone's actions. Like,
I'm sure
it's
it is.
not funny to tease someone who's just like a nice person with good intentions, like,
But you do.
or make
But you
fun of
do.
them. Then I
But you
don't
do
know why
anyway.
you would, like, I wouldn't change my morality, you know what I mean? Like, for example, with the shooting someone, I will not shoot someone. That means if they're a nice person, I won't shoot them. If they're a mean person, I won't shoot them. Whatever their actions are, I just have this value. I'm not going to kill people.
Okay.
And it's more justified, I suppose, for other people than for certain people, but I'm just not going to change my morals depending on like the person in the room.
What if that person was like a wealthy diplomat from another country that planned to destroy a city and had the means to do so? Would you not shoot them in that situation?
I wouldn't do nothing, but I wouldn't kill them.
What if your option was?
I would try to like restrain someone. I would obviously try to stop them from killing someone. I mean, in this example, I'm probably the worst person in the world to try to stop someone from killing someone. I'm not a particularly like strong person, but I don't know. I would do whatever means necessary. I don't know. You try to like, you call the police, you throw things at them. I don't know, non-lethal things. I would use any non-lethal weapon.
Would you do that if you knew that taking that course of action was likely to endanger many more people?
Yes, I thought about this so many times. Yes, I would still not kill someone.
So, but by your action, you think it's appropriate to potentially sacrifice many people for the sake of not staining your actions?
Well, I would do everything that I could, but under this example, we've determined that it's impossible for me to do everything that I could. But it's not, it would never be my fault that that person killed thousands of people.
That's true. It wouldn't be your fault, but you would still be relatively responsible for not acting.
Well, I didn't do nothing. I would have acted. I would have done something. It turned out to be fruitless, but I would have done something.
Yeah, but when you could have done something that would have worked, and you would decide not to because of your rule. Yeah.
I mean, I think from a utilitarian perspective, it's It doesn't line up. It's not utilitarian. I'm not utilitarian. I mean, in some ways, but like when it comes to like human life, I wouldn't be.
Yeah. I guess I don't think that human life is inherently valuable. And I think the experience of human life is, but not the life itself, if that makes sense.
So the person's not valuable, but the person's experience is valuable, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, yeah.
Why?
Well,
in that case, why does it matter that they just killed 1,000 people? Like,
oh, because you shouldn't end people's experiences arbitrarily. It's like that thing.
Well, that's why I couldn't shoot someone. You just like end someone's experience.
Well, I wouldn't be arbitrary in that situation, but because they plan to harm many people that are presumably innocent, unless maybe for some bizarre coincidence the whole city was filled with like villains.
But how could you, like, I don't know, just how you like just trust yourself enough to say like, I know that this person's a villain, I know that this person's a good person, like how can you just like trust yourself?
Oh well, I couldn't without information. Like,
well, so you're given information, you just never be given enough information.
Well, it would depend on their action.
What'd you say? Like,
it would depend on their actions. So, well, I know they've done. Like I'm pretty sure that you haven't done horrific things, right?
Right, right.
Yeah, but then if you look at like Saddam Hussein's son, he is probably one of the worst people that I know of to exist, and I won't talk about what he's done because it will get the channel in trouble. But if you want to look it up in your own time, then you can be morally outraged like I was. And so in that situation, I'll be like, yeah, I think your right to experiences is ruining other people's experience in such a fundamental way that you shouldn't exist anymore. But I couldn't say the same thing.
I mean, there have got to be people. I mean, obviously, there are people that are just, like, bad people, and the world would probably be a better place with them dead. But I don't want to be the one who makes them dead, and I also don't trust myself to, I'm not the arbiter of justice.
Well, I think you are in regards to yourself. Like, you act in a way to make sure that you act in a just way.
Right, and I'll try, you know, and I mean, thankfully these experiences will like never happen, but I think it just comes down to a fundamental belief that I'm not like of the belief that depending on someone's actions, I can change my behavior in a worse way. If they are a worse person, I can be a worse person. I don't want to allow them to like drag me down.
I don't think it's a drag down system. I think that that every action is a moral consequence. So if by inaction that's still action, and if by inaction you cause a lot of people to suffer unnecessarily, then you're still responsible for that, even if you didn't act in a direct fashion. And I know that like it's not like actually relevant to either of our lives to talk about this, and as far as I know, you seem like a good person, right? but I do think it's true that each individual is responsible for their own moral decision making, and so by that logic, you are the arbiter of at least your ethical values. And If you think that you should have a positive experience, then you probably should think that other people should have that as well. And therefore, if by inaction or action you lead to a lot of people having a really bad experience, then you are responsible for them. Not in a direct fashion, because they're responsible for their actions more than you are, but you are relatively responsible.
I mean, in the case we were just talking about, there were only like two options. The options were kill the person or 1,000 people are killed. But
yeah,
in most everyday situations, you're not stuck to two options. Like in the case of like CS Joseph making bad videos, there are tons of options. You could do nothing. You could make videos explaining his logic. You could make logical fallacy videos that have nothing to do with CS Joseph. You could, you know, make fun of his logic. You could make fun of him as a person. I mean, there are just like so many options. Mm-hmm. And I would think that you'd want to choose out of, and there are way more options than I listed, out of all the options you have, you'd want to choose the one that's most beneficial. And you may want, you'd want to like experiment with which option is most persuasive in helping other people be more logical, if that's what it seems like is your end goal.
Well, it's that in combination with being funny. So it's both of those things. And I'm doing it in alignment with what I think to be accurate and what I think to be funny. So it's both of those things. And it is sustainable, that line of reasoning, because it works for me and it works for people that I'm around. And it's not appropriate in every situation. Like, obviously at your workplace, it's going to lead to worse issues. But it's appropriate if people want to engage in that way. And if they've taken a route where they can't be reasonable, then it doesn't matter what you say to them, because they'll entrench further into their positions regardless of what you do. So then you should tease them, because it's funny. Like, why not? And they can tease me for being stupid as well. That's consistent and fair.
Okay. So, but what if then there are people, so you got like CS Joseph, for example, and there are people that they can tell there's like maybe something off, but they're not sure what it is. They go watch one of your videos and they're like, oh, this guy's pointing out some logical stuff. And then in their perception, like, we'll just call it me, in my perception, you say something rude. So then in my head, I'm like, oh, well, this guy's rude. I'm not going to listen to him. And then that person make the jump, like, and they're still just kind of like, I don't know what the deal is with CS Joseph. I'm not going to watch this guy's videos anymore because he's just kind of a jerk.
And that could happen, yeah. That person would be in the wrong for for leaping to conclusions. But that might happen, yeah. And the opposite could happen as well, where they're like, I'm glad these guys are acting in a way that is more congruent to my social experience, and I feel like I'm accepted in a way that I'm not normally by normal culture, because I like to be edgy and people don't like it, and I feel a kind of acceptance because these people act in the same way, and therefore I listen to them more.
Mm-hmm. It could happen. It's so unfortunate because it's hypothetical. What I would see, my ideal situation is you test it out and you try option A and you try option B and you see if there's any different response. But one would be less fun to you because it's your own personal like.
Yeah, it's fun. It's like I don't think it's a like. I don't think you should police people's behavior based on offending people.
Not offending people, I'm doing moral actions. I mean, for me, it's about morality. It's not about like rapport or consensus. It's on like an individual level. It's an FI thing, not an FE thing. It's not like, oh, we just need to be nice to people and not gossip. I mean, that's not why I brought up gossiping. I brought up gossiping from like a, not from a social appropriateness, but from like a moral standpoint.
But well, I'm also acting from a moral framework in which I'm consistent with and which makes a sense that works with other people. So it's not just me acting by myself, it's me acting with like other complex systems, and that seems to work for at least us. And like it would work for other people as well if they decided to let go of certain notions, like that they have that they have a right to like to be respected, I guess.
It's just like, you know, there's like no.
It's like like I think you should treat people on their actions, and if people want to, like, if they either just have to act in absurd ways or they will act in absurd ways because they've got themselves into a intellectually absurd position, then like any kind of trying to be reasonable with them is a waste of time. So they haven't earned that kind of respect.
Well, but they won't be reasonable either way. You're logical with them, they won't be reasonable. You make fun of them, they won't be reasonable. Like, no matter what you do, they're not going to be reasonable. But it's a matter of if you're going to convince the public more so with one way or the other. If you can make them more reasonable one way or the other.
Well, yeah. But people do respond. Like, people often will respond to people like reinforcing their principles with angry talk or with like moralistic rants. It's a very effective way to get people to pay attention to. And like it's like a biological thing.
Well, I would agree that it's effective in getting people to pay attention to you. I'm not sure if it's effective in getting people to be more logical, but I think it is effective in getting people to pay attention.
Well, they are separate systems, so by itself, no. But with being sound in reasoning, then there's no reason you can't combine those systems.
Yeah. I genuinely think that this conversation is just hit a bottom philosophically, where you will treat people on their actions and I will not treat people on their actions. And if I was making a video about Mother Teresa or if I was making a video about Hitler, I would try to approach them the same.
Well, how can you treat people if it's not based? Because if it's not based off their actions, it's based off like a different principles. It's based off a different set of principles. So,
Well, but if I was, I'm saying if I was like attacking an argument per se, like I say Mother Teresa did something illogical and Hitler obviously did something illogical. The way I would attack the argument would be the same. I would not change myself depending on who's in the room. I would just be consistent to myself. I will be myself no matter like who I'm talking about.
Okay.
So I would actually feel better about what you're doing if you teased everyone versus only teasing C.S. Joseph or people of that nature.
Well, it is consistent, but the criteria is more nuanced because it's as a cluster of traits.
What are you saying?
As a cluster of traits that I'll respond to like that with. So it's not a So it's consistent across those cluster of traits, but the cluster of traits are like conceptual things as opposed to the person itself, such as being arrogant, for example. That's something I like to respond to.
Right. I mean, so what I'm saying is, like, if I was around a humble person or an arrogant person, I'm still going to communicate the same way.
Yeah, okay.
Because if the goal is to affect the people, then theoretically your audience basically hasn't changed. So if I'm talking about an arrogant person or a humble person, I'm still going to come off as, in the attempt to come off at least, level-headed and kind, because I'm hoping that my audience is level-headed and kind. And, you know, I'm not trying to persuade Hitler or Mother Teresa, so I don't, you know, mold myself to who they are, you know, because it would be the audience.
I bet you do treat people differently based off the relation to you. Like, I bet you treat your mother differently to how you treat your friends.
Right. And yeah, it's not like, I don't mean, I'm not taking that 100% literally. I just mean based on, like, I'm not going to treat them differently. Like, I'm going to treat them kindly, Like there's some basics.
Oh, okay.
Like there's slang that I'll use or whatever, but I'm just going to treat everyone kind.
Yeah, I mean, that's, I understand the position. I don't think it works if people aren't being kind to you.
Well, I mean, there are plenty of, I wish I could, like, think of celebrity interviews, but like when someone like goes off, like trying to think, I'm not a huge fan of Jordan Peterson, but this is an example I can think. Are you familiar with Jordan Peterson? There was a video that I watched and it was like him debating like this like really angry feminist, and she came off so angry, and he could have matched her behavior and poked fun at her and stuff like that, but instead he remained like really level-headed. And so, like, if you look in the comments of that video, the consensus is very much like, wow, this guy stayed really level-headed. And I feel like that's the video where he comes off the best and where people respect him the best. Whereas there are other videos where he's on, like, a university campus and people are yelling at him and he yells right back. And then in the comments, you get all sorts of stuff that's like, wow, this guy's terrible. And I feel like it detracts from his argument because he's just yelling.
But that's on them, though. Like, that's on the people to not look at arguments. Like, everyone is responsible for their own experience. So if they can't examine arguments because people are grumpy, then that's on them.
Yeah, but and it would be saying, I mean, I feel that you cannot be as logical when you're in an emotional space. So if he gets angry, his arguments, I mean, just from the videos I've seen of his, when he's angry, his arguments are worse. And it's not just because of his affect. It's also his arguments are just worse. You're not thinking as clearly.
Well, I mean, that's probably true, like with him. But that's not true universally. Like, I'm aware of people that argue better when they're angry. So. Because it's kind of like a subjective thing.
I just think it's a worse way to do it. I think you'd persuade people, and I'm sure you do persuade people. I think you could persuade more people if it just stuck to the logical argument. It'd be less entertaining, but.
But if it's entertaining, then it's persuading people.
Then it's what?
Then it's persuading people.
Yeah, well, people can make fun of people, and I could agree with them making fun of the person, but then it also damages me because then I'm making a habit of judging the person, and okay. It makes me like less humble because I think that I can just like make fun of people.
But you can, and that's not wrong inherently.
Well, it's not wrong inherently, I suppose, but. When you make fun of someone, you're looking down on someone, and I feel like pride is a bad thing. Or ego is another word, I suppose.
Well, when you say looking down, what does that mean?
Like anytime you compare yourself to people, like I think I'm dumber than this person, or I think I'm smarter than this person. Like I feel like any way you slice it in a comparison, whether you come out on top or you come out on bottom, it's just like not helpful in general for the human race because you end up spending less time focusing on your own mission and you're focusing on how you stack up to other people.
Okay, so at one stage I wanted to get better at sword fighting and I knew that I wasn't very good at it. And so I looked at people that were good at it. And knowing that they were better at it than I was, I learned from their superior techniques to then improve myself.
Right. That's kind of like a different situation. I'm not talking about like learning from people. I'm just talking about like you look at this other sword fighter and you're like, wow, they suck. It's like I just like don't understand what the point of doing that is. I mean, I don't know if it's objectively wrong, but it's pointless.
Well, the point would be that to learn from other people's mistakes so you do not repeat them. That doesn't mean that the person is inherently bad, because that would be an overgeneralization.
Well, if I'm like an expert soccer player and I look at a kindergartner and I'm like, wow, they suck, I'm not in any way going to learn from the mistakes they're making. The mistakes they're making is like not tripping over the ball. And I'm not going to be like, oh, mental note, don't trip over the ball.
Yeah, but looking at a kindergarten and then understanding they're bad at soccer. It's like, yeah, but they haven't trained as much as you have. It's like they're not making mistakes that you can make. So, like it's not wrong to think that you're better at stuff than people if you are better at stuff than people.
Right.
It
It's not
is
wrong
wrong to.
to think that, but it's if there's any sort of like ego wrapped up in it. The objective comparison is fine. It's not morally wrong. I do think it detracts from like other better things you could be doing, but like I don't think it's maybe necessarily wrong.
Well, so if you were to want, like, if that person wanted to teach the kid how to play soccer and the kid wanted to do it, then by examining the mistakes, they could then teach the kid how to improve. I do ag agree with your point that if you hold it to like a pride thing, then that leads to bad behavior because you'll try to find people that are worse than you at stuff to then feel better about yourself. And that is a way to stagnate within your abilities.
Yeah, that's true.
So I do think that is poor behavior. And
So in your videos, you have like no pride associated with it.
I'm not sure what pride means.
Or ego.
I'm not sure what that means.
Well, you just used it in a sentence because you were saying it would be bad if you like had a sense of like pride or like ego in something because it's a way to stagnate.
Okay, so I'll define pride as a low resolution comprehension of a complex system. So for example, I think I'm better at a kindergartner, therefore I should feel better about myself. Where it would be more appropriate to think of something like, I am better at these things than a kindergarten. And then the reasons for it might be m like multifaceted, but most likely it's because I've got more experience or because I'm just physically way larger if it's a strength thing.
Well,
So
do
I
you
guess I.
detect like this is, I don't know, this would be like a FI somewhat question. Like I suppose like in your gut, I suppose, do you feel that there's no sense that there's ego wrapped up in those videos? Like an over, like when I say pride, it's not like just being like proud of your work, but like an overinflated sense of I'm better than this person, and then it would lead you to stagnate because you're just comparing yourself to all these like really logical people.
Oh, I don't compare myself to them in like a. It's like I think I am better at knowing what is valid in that situation, but that's as bad as far as I can generalize that, honestly. I might be able to make extrapolations that they think bad in general, which is likely. But that doesn't mean I should feel good about myself. That would be crazy. It would be illogical, because that someone is doing worse than you doesn't mean that you're doing okay. And like that they might be bad when it comes to a conceptual thing, but then I could be way worse when it comes to heaps of other things. So it's just context dependent.
Yeah, the more clean that things are, the less I have a problem with it. Like, if it's just about logic, it's cleanly about logic, and there's no ego attached to it. Like, as long as things are very, very clean and there's like no emotion attached to it, it's almost very depersonalized. The more depersonalized things are, the more and more I'm fine with it. Yeah, it's only with comments like you are stupid. That's really the only thing that I ever have, a problem with this whole thing. Because it makes it a little less clean, I suppose.
I don't agree with that, because I think that everyone's stupid in some way. And, like, I think we're born stupid and that we die stupid, and that the goal is to get less stupid. And
well, see, at the beginning, I don't think many people think that. And
but they should.
Well, maybe they should, but, like, almost at the beginning of every video, I would have a better, like, I would be more fine with it at the beginning of, like, this is kind of, this would be awkward to do, but at the beginning of the video, you're just like, I think everyone is stupid. I'm stupid. My host is stupid.
See, oh, I have said that. Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, I was like, you know, I'm a fucking idiot. You're a fucking idiot. Everyone's a fucking idiot. So correct us in the comments when we're wrong. We'll correct you in the next video. This is why this person is wrong. And it's funny, because it's funny being wrong. That includes me. It includes you. And I think it is prideful to hang on to the notion that you're above that. Because no one's above being wrong. It's like you're born with being wrong and you never change. You just get less wrong. And that's not even necessarily true. You might get more nuanced in your wrongness. And to prevent that from happening, you need to be critical.
Well, see, with that last little bit, see, I'm more, okay, that was more convincing to me, the whole last part. You know, I suppose if you talk about yourself in the same way, I suppose you talk about other people.
Oh, yeah, fine. Like, and I was saying that earlier, and I do mean that. That if someone were to treat me in the same way, it's like, that's fair. That's you should do that if I'm wrong. And if you do it in a way that's silly, then you should be teased for that as well. I think it's a way that to, like, collectivize thinking about things. And a good way to do something is to have passionate about it. And if that is because you're annoyed at somebody because they said something dumb, then sure, go ahead. Just remember to be objective.
Very interesting. I really don't know how to wrap this up. I'm more convinced than I was the beginning of this conversation.
I think it's a similar concept to original sin.
What do you mean?
Well, it's like everyone's born sinful, and I don't think that's true, but I do think everyone's born stupid, and stupidness tends towards doing shitty things. So it's like, it's a similar concept, and the way to fix it is by understanding things as well as you can. And that's the best you can do.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Well, thanks so much for coming on. You want to say again where people can find you?
Yeah. Rational Typology and The Warmest Robot.
Nice. Yeah, everybody go follow him. Yeah, thanks so much for hopping on. This is very... I don't know if people find this conversation interesting. It's interesting to me.
I think they might. They might find it interesting. But I guess we'll find out.
Nice. Thanks so much for hopping on.
See ya.